Okay, Sunday evening, 8:15, lecture number three. So still kind of on waiting for Godot, but I'm going to be introducing some ideas about discursive theory, about how language and subjectivity sort of coordinate and what subjectivity really is. You already know, and so much of popular culture, particularly science fiction, explores problems of subjectivity. How do you know what you're thinking is what you know, as opposed to what someone else told you that you know? This is the basic plot of the Matrix. When Morpheus says to Neo, "You're a slave. You're actually in a vat. You're not walking around." And discourse is a matrix. It's the thing that allows us to interface with our reality, but our reality is infused with mythology and ideology and a myth of origin and a construction of the self. So we're actually a very complicated series of gears. And postmodernism has been this kind of exposure. It's the pulling back the curtain, and it's seeing that the essence is not the wizard who's screaming and bellowing. It's this vulnerable little old man who's very only powerful because he's operating all these levers. And as long as you watch the machine and don't realize there's someone behind the curtain, you'll react to the machine, which is what happens in the whole first part of The Wizard of Oz. And same idea of the Matrix is practically a remake of The Wizard of Oz in the sense that Neo senses that there's something else, there's something behind the very thing that claims that there's nothing behind the curtain. But reality is always a curtain. And behind it is the real. Behind it is everything that's real. And the curtain is just a particular organization of some aspect of what's real into something that you then corresponds to your reality, which in turn organizes and sustains your subjectivity so that you can experience your identity as consistent through space and time. If any of that breaks down, you will have or can have a nervous breakdown. And if the breakdown for some reason, both biological and cultural, is not resolving, then you can have a psychotic break, and you will not make sense to other people, and other people will not make sense to you. So, to a certain degree, we need this arrangement. We need it of someone behind the curtain, organizing the chaos into something else. This, by the way, there is no man behind the curtain and waiting for Godot. It's just the chaos. There is Lucky cannot organize himself into any reality, no matter how hard he tries. Vladimir and Estragon exist, but they don't really, and they know that they're real, but they don't actually have what we might normally recognize as a reality. Every day is the exact same as every other day. They don't know what day it is. They don't know where they are on the road. They don't know what time they told Godot they would be there or what day. The only thing that's consistent, and we'll talk more about this, is there seems to be a tree, has a couple of leaves in Act One, and has like three new leaves in Act Two. That's all you're going to get for the climax of the plot in this play. That's the most dramatic thing that happens, is the tree seems to have three more leaves. They think about hanging themselves from the tree, but they either don't bring enough rope, or they're afraid that if one uses the rope and dies, and then the other one uses the rope and the rope breaks, or the bough breaks, then they'll be alone for eternity. And as difficult as it is for them to get along with one another, they still can't imagine getting along separately. Perhaps it would be better if we went our separate ways. That comes up over and over again. But if we read it allegorically, the mind and the body cannot literally decide to go its separate ways. But there are many, many ways and many, many times when we want them to, and when we try and make them. And indeed, in scientific methodology, is really letting Vladimir go his own way with all this stuff about Bibles and constantly trying to measure things. And Estragon, being more of the body, doesn't employ methodology of any sort. He's in an eternal now, and Vladimir is in an eternal not yet. So Vladimir is sort of not there, and he's terrified of Estragon. Dreams won't let Estragon tell him his dreams because dreams are the chaos behind your waking reality. So nightmares, dreams that you remember vividly, they don't make any sense because they are those aspects of your day that you did not and could not factor in order for your day to make sense. So the nonsense of your day, which needed to be excluded for your day to make sense, is still somewhere. It gets pushed back out into the real so that you can have a consistent reality. But when you're sleeping, the line between the real and reality becomes permeable. And so fragments, things that actually were available to your awareness, but your self-construct and the consistency of your reality would not allow them. If you ever hear people talking about, oh man, how did I not know this relationship was going badly? How did I not see any of the red flags and not know that they were cheating or they had already had another partner or they were married? How did I miss it? Well, you missed it because you wanted to. That sounds odd. Why would you want to miss red flags that are going to wind up with you getting hurt? Well, we champion our reality, and it takes a lot for us to be willing to pull the curtain back on our reality. So often we won't do it ourselves. Somebody else will say, by the way, you know they're married, right? And we'll say, what are you talking about? You're just jealous or something. But then we might check it out for ourselves and find out it's true and just be devastated because something unreal was made real by our realizing it. It was real already. It was real before, but our buffer was working. The self is a buffer from between the real and reality, and it's a pretty necessary buffer, a necessary fiction. But the question is, how severe is the disconnect between your reality and what's real? You know, for poets, there's almost no disconnect. They're virtually, which is why they can sound crazy sometimes, and why poetry is so difficult to read. Because it's using language to explore what's behind language, but all it has to do with that is language. This is such a strange play because Beckett hates using words, and he knows he has no choice. So he writes a play using words about the deceptiveness of words, and how, as he calls it, language is a stain. Words are a stain upon the silence. This play prefers silence, but what would happen if you paid your money, went into a play, the lights came on, the stage was empty, and literally nobody came out, and there were no props? What would that even be? I mean, that would be just you sitting in an empty room. So you might think Beckett doesn't give you much, but he gives you more than that. But not any more than that. So Godot would seem to be, among many other things, some kind of reassurance that either there's nothing behind this curtain of reality, or it's not a curtain because whatever's behind the reality is corresponds to the reality. And see, that was the beauty of something like God and transcendental certitude, because you could imagine a real beyond reality, but that real was a benevolent, omniscient, transcendent being who was looking after you. So it didn't matter that your reality was, we all knew our reality was a buffer. We all knew that we weren't in heaven. We all knew that it was, if anything, blasphemous to presume we knew as much, much less more than God. So we accepted the disconnect. And really, in the age of faith, the way that we discuss that disconnect is prayer and ritual. We know we can't traverse it. As the Old Testament puts it, we see now as through a glass darkly, but light in the future. So there's this frank assumption, there's a dark glass in front of our eyes, and we're peering at our, and there's a frank admission. But modernism, so you have age of faith, modernism, postmodernism. Modernism struggled with this because the veil was starting to become obvious after World War I and World War II, but no one knew how to face it. And in postmodernism, we're kind of not given any choice. We're suddenly aware of the constructiveness of self, of the terror we have of what we now experience as the chaos on the other side of our reality, because quote unquote God is dead. And Nietzsche warned us about this. What do you think is going to happen if you kill the idea of God? Then you're going to be left staring into the void, and the only bridge you have, and it's more of a pier, is language and self-construct. But if either one of those breaks, if the bow breaks, there's no God to catch you. You're going to have a psychotic break or an erotic break or some combination of the two. So Nietzsche, in a way, he's saying, you know, be careful what you ask for. You wanted the freedom and not having to worry about God, or the freedom and not having to worry about being judged after you died. But so fine, you're not going to be judged after you die, because there's nothing after you die. It's just a void. That doesn't really feel like a win. I mean, regardless of your faith, if someone were to say, so here's the deal, there's an all-knowing, all-loving God after you die, and you have roughly a 50-50 chance of being saved or damned. Or you just go into the void, the non-existence. There's nothing. You're atomized. You know, why not take the 50-50? As Vladimir says, it's not a bad percentage. One of the thieves was saved. One of the thieves was damned. And it was, of course, the thief who showed a glimmer of faith, albeit from a context of doubt, saying, why are you making fun of Jesus? Neither one of us can know for sure he's the Son of God, but he could be. And Christ said, I say unto you, this, by the end of this day, you will be in heaven. And apparently didn't say anything to the other thief who had been making fun of him. If you're the Son of God, get off the cross. Whatever you're doing here, get us off the cross. And that kind of utilitarian approach to God, like God is your errand boy, doesn't work. Because if God works or can work, it's through faith, not certitude, which means it's through a balance of hope and doubt, occasional sense of, I do believe. There's a saying, people say, I do not believe, oh God, help my disbelief. That's faith in a way. The very act of saying, I don't believe, turns into a supplication that you be helped with your doubt back to belief. But what's unique about faith is that it only works when something can't be proven. I mean, some people like to say, well, if God came down here and showed himself, I'd believe in him. That's not believing, that's seeing. The whole point of belief is that you have to believe in it because you can't prove that it is or it isn't. And so you're not gonna be able to stabilize that doubt. But in postmodernism, that the belief is really, at least culturally and communally, has kind of disappeared. Nobody believes things that can't be proven. And then we start saying that there are fake news, and people start arguing over what's true and what isn't. And there's no arbiter. There's no referee. There's no transcendent certitude to appeal to. Say, he says A, I say B. Which is it? A and B seem to be able to suddenly coexist. Something that Aristotle originally had said is essentially impossible. Things cannot exist and not exist. Things cannot exist and not exist at the same time. They can. The self can exist and not exist at the same time. The self does exist and not exist at the same time. There's no such thing as the self, but the organization of your consciousness, which you call the self, allows you to interact with reality, and that does conduct your existence. So something that doesn't exist delivers your sensation of existing to you. The necessary fiction of the self, which does not exist, exists in its effects. Sorry, this is kind of intense philosophy, but I you've seen The Matrix. In a way, it's already there when Morpheus says to him, or rather Neo says to Morpheus, after he stops the computer program and all the people who are trying to cross traffic and pay attention to the signals, and they're into the symbolic organization of the society, which they take to be real because it organizes them, but they're actually in a vat somewhere. The thing that organizes you isn't you. It's the thing that organizes a fiction about you that creates reality effects. So Neo says to Morpheus, you're telling me that I can dodge bullets, you know, because we know Mr. Smith can fire bullets. The only reason Mr. Smith's bullets both exist and don't exist. This is something we're going to see in The Balcony, the next play that we look at, where things seem to exist and not exist a lot. But that'll be lecture number four after this one. I'll try and set it up a little tonight. I'll try and segue toward it. But The Balcony is going to be much more about fantasy, politics, reality, and subjectivity. It's both similar. It has the same crisis as Waiting for Godot, and it's actually the stage is stuffed with props and costumes. It takes place in a brothel, or does it? Men who go there to pretend, along with the prostitutes, that they're powerful figures, or are they in fact those powerful figures? Is there any difference between being a general and fantasizing that you're a general? Doesn't a general, in a way, other than the apparatus that lets them be general? I mean, finally, President Trump realized that he wasn't president. He was somebody occupying a position called president. And he moved heaven and earth to try and take down the whole system so that the apparatus couldn't be dismantled around him. Because he finally figured out, I'm president because of this apparatus, democracy, the Constitution, the Supreme Court, the Congress, the House of Representatives, all these things up until my last day in office where I did not win the popular vote or the Electoral College vote. And so they're taking down the scaffolding, they're taking down my apparatus. And I thought the power was inside me, but it's the power, in fact, is something that resides in you as long as you're positioned in a certain way with the apparatus. So he brought 60 different suits against, several went to the Supreme Court. The apparatus kept on just being taken down. His final attempt at insurrection is the only other possibility, the storming of the Bastille, the storming of the Capitol. You have to take over by the gun, by martial law, by, you know, smashing people, shooting people. That failed. There weren't enough people, but it's remarkable that in the space of a half an hour, there were people sitting in the same seat that Vice President Pence had been in 20 minutes ago, performing the final ritual that would take the apparatus down from around Trump and officially build it up around Biden. And then Trump is out. But so they took over the Capitol. They sat in the chair, but they couldn't hold it because, again, the apparatus didn't recognize the rioters. It was breached by them, and they busted Nancy Pelosi's sign, and they stole the podium, and they stole her laptop, and they threw things around. But they couldn't stay. They couldn't get it to stick because they were literally unidentifiable by the apparatus. They weren't elected. They weren't police. They weren't called for by anybody, so they weren't able to stay. The only way they would have been able to stay is if they had enough power to both occupy the House and the Congress and then repel the National Guard and the entire US Army, presuming it went up against them. The only time a coup really succeeds is when the military sides with the insurrectionists. And so this didn't come close to happening, but if the US military had said, we think this was a fraudulent election, we agree with Trump, we're gonna roll tanks in. And it would either be a civil war or it would be a successful insurrection, and then you would essentially have a military dictatorship. It is amazing how close, paper thin, as someone who grew up in the States, I cannot believe we got that close. It makes Trump, you know, the U.S. seems like Hogwarts and Trump seems like Voldemort. He keeps throwing him out and he keeps trying to come back. And now he's out there trying to, whatever Voldemort does, find his 12 cruxes or something so he can put himself back together because he's in pieces. And he won't have power until they're all aligned again. And then he can take over the apparatus of Hogwarts and probably the Muggle world as well. So this is what's at stake in Waiting for Godot, because basically, instead of giving you a quote unquote reality, a plot, a play, like the kind you're used to seeing, what Beckett does is he takes this, your so-called reality, he just shows you the apparatus. And Lucky normally, you know, when Lucky wasn't broken, his job as a poet, a genius, a scientist, all the different things he might have been and that are reflected in his speech, his job would have been to put a curtain in front of the apparatus, to weave a curtain. His words are attempting to weave a curtain to hide the apparatus so that there can be a reality again. But his weaving is torn. He can't get anything to, he can't get any of the knots to tie. And when, as you see Lucky's increasing despair, which I something I tried to convey in my reading of it in the last lecture, as his attempt to weave the curtain in front of the apparatus so that we can have a reality that we think is primary, but in fact our reality is the thing we use to cover what's real. And ideology is our attempt to explain all the things in the real that threaten our reality. So the QAnon people, who sound, you know, on the one hand, they sound completely nuts, that there's a Pizzagate pedophile ring, Democrats are eating babies, and there were lizards in a previous, I'm serious, all this stuff is out there. But it doesn't matter. Once you go down that rabbit hole, as Morpheus says to Neo, you know, you can wake up in your bed if you take this pill, you can wake up, or you can go to see how far the rabbit hole goes. QAnon's really trying to figure out how far the rabbit hole goes, but they're going in the wrong direction. They're weaving a new curtain, but the curtain is so disconnected with anything that's actually real. Not just that the election wasn't fraudulent, but that the Democrats aren't actually lizard people. So they have to just gather in a tight circle and talk to themselves all the time on the internet and not permit anything else in. Because in order for that craziness to masquerade as reality, they cannot tolerate anyone except themselves. So it's a kind of accelerating circle. And from what I can tell, QAnon is breaking up a lot pretty fast because they had this millennialist idea that was their goal was making it possible to keep alive their crazy reality that Trump, no, he won't be elected. Apparently there's some QAnon people who are trying to say, well, Biden works for Trump. I mean, you can always go deeper down the rabbit hole, but you're just widening the disconnect. And there are apparently some people in QAnon saying, wow, well, we got screwed, we got taken, I'm 100 miles from, my disconnect is as large as the Grand Canyon, and I'm in shock about it, but I'm gonna figure something out. You know, you think you're on one side of the Grand Canyon and you suddenly realize you're on the other side and you've got all that space has opened up between you and what's real. So I'm going to show you something and I'm going to hold it up to you and so that you can write it down because it'll get recorded. I'll have to excuse it, some of the typos. Now what I'm going to try and show you here, and I'll hold it steady, and you can definitely, you know, you can hit pause and sketch this out. Take some time. Let me move it like so. Okay, so you'll see there's a square there, sort of, supposed to be square. This is what's called master discourse. Now, when we speak, There is an I, look at the bottom left-hand corner. There's an I who speaks, and there's an I that is spoken. So when we're speaking, we're trying to bring into existence the I that we feel that we are because of the way other people have spoken about us. So the I, this is the other problem with Descartes saying, I think, therefore I am. Who the heck is I in that statement? He says I like it's some autonomous being, but the I is an amalgamation of our own consciousness and how we respond to the gaze and demands of other people. Subjectivity does not happen until there is someone other. So when a baby's born, initially they don't distinguish between themselves and the mother. It's coextensive, whether it's breastfeeding or whatever. But gradually the child begins to realize that the mother is one thing and that the child is another. And at that point, the child, in a sense, splits because there's an I who appeals to the mother, who am I? And there's an I that tries to tell the mother who I am. And but in both cases, the return gaze and the speaking of the mother is crucial to how you calibrate the split between the I and you who speaks and the I and you who is spoken. They're never the same thing. When you're speaking, you're not spoken. When you're spoken, you're not speaking. So you're, this is another way to go back and forth between the reality that's a curtain woven and the real and the real itself. In between the I who speaks and the I that is spoken is chaos. And in a way, that's what we, just like this play, we're essentially chaos, but then we organize the chaos into something else, into a self, into an I who speaks, and into an I who's spoken. But notice that's utterly dependent on language. Who are we without language? We don't have an I without language. We're symbolic creatures. So if you're crossing the street downtown and somebody says, and you see a policeman, no, so you're crossing the street and you hear someone say, "Hey," and so you look over your shoulder, and probably like and everyone else does too, and there's a policeman, but he's pointing at you. Now you know who he's pointing at, and because he's a policeman, because he has authority, he's in this, he is in this upper this upper right hand corner, police, Godot, your GPA, Trump, anything that's seen as an authoritative master, anything that, that corresponds to what you wish want to be. Because see, your GPA is both what you have spoken, how you've done in your various courses, what you speak, I should say, but it also as a finite number, 3.2, 3.4, it is you as someone spoken. So one reason you're kind of in tyrannized by your GPA is that on the one hand, your GPA is the amalgamation of things that you have spoken in various classes. But once it's that number, that 3.2 or whatever, it also exists beyond you. It's nothing but you, and it also exists beyond you. It begins to say to others who you are. You're a 3.2, you're a 3.4, you're a 4.1. This is also the power of scandal and gossip and libel, where other people who tell someone who doesn't know you who you are, and then either they believe that or they don't, and you get a chance to defend against that or you don't. And that's how easily. So in other words, the other, in many ways, your desire is not your desire. It's your approximation of the desire of the other. What does the other want from me? Because I want to be wanted by the other so I can feel wanted and in turn want things and want others. So desire is not about anything. Desire, when you want something, your object of your desire, it's not what you want. It's what causes your desire. As soon as you get your object of desire, you keep desiring. So your desire is not canceled by achieving the object. The object of desire is just a pause in a perpetual desire. Because the real desire is to figure out how to bridge the gap between the I that speaks and the I that's spoken. It's an unbridgeable gap, and it's a lack, and you are that lack. And you really don't want to lose that lack, because to fuse the I that speaks with the I that's spoken is psychosis. You no longer have the differential. You no longer have a sense of lack. So we hear these jokes about people who think they're Napoleon, or really, you know, say QAnon, that Trump is Christ, or Trump is Godot, or Trump is their one true God, the one thing they know for sure, the thing that makes the other that loves them and that they love, and people are willing to kill to preserve that illusion when they're so dependent on it. So one of the issues is how dependent are you on the gaze of the other? How much can you tolerate pressure on that gap between the I that speaks and the I that's spoken, the curtain that is your reality and the hidden apparatus behind it that always threatens to reveal the illusion of plenitude on the curtain of your reality? This is why cinema is so powerful, by the way. If any of you guys are in my film class, but because the movie happens in between the screen and you. So the movie can play with, you don't usually speak during movies, But the movie can play with you feeling spoken, and when you feel like you're speaking, it can go back and forth. In film theory, we call this suturing. You try and suture the gap and the wound of the lack that is you with reference to the characters on the screen, the images, not the words, not the dialogue, but the much more primal images. So the way this works is Godot or a policeman or your GPA or Trump or your mom or your dad, possibly your professor. But notice I'm not as powerful as your GPA. I'm a kind of messenger between you and your GPA. I teach this class, you get grades, they go through me, I put a 75 or an 85 or a 65. That is factored into your GPA, but the sum total of your GPA is much more than A11. So I'm both a part of your GPA and also very limited. So I'm not as powerful as your GPA. You can't, it doesn't make sense to people if you say, I know my GPA is 2.0, but I got an A in A11 and that was my favorite class and that's where I learned the most. And so screw the GPA. I mean, you could say that and I might even encourage it, but it doesn't, the fact that the GPA has been given the apparatus of graduate school. Because if graduate school said, you know what, our admissions lately have been screwy. We're going to admit a class without reference to your GPA. And if you think that's weird, that's what it was like when I was your age. There was no such thing as GPA. People read recommendations. They looked at your grades, and then they thought about it. Like if you had straight A's in all your literature classes and you wanted to go to graduate school in English and you had a D minus in chemistry, who cares? The problem with the GPA is it's an algorithm. It's not a person. It can't make obvious points. Like this person's not great at chemistry. He wants to study Shakespeare. I think it'll be all right. If you're applying for a job as a chemist, then it's an issue because you're getting an A in Shakespeare. It is not going to do much for you when you're working in the lab. So, but this has been lost. The other thing about postmodernism, it's the age of the algorithm. It's the age of economics. And because algorithm is the great hailer, algorithm is what makes us feel it's a policeman that says, hey, every time you get a like on Facebook, it's like somebody said, hey, I see you, or looking good or whatever it is they say. And then we have that confirmation, but the weird thing is we seek confirmation of our unique authenticity from someone else. How can someone else grant us our authenticity? The very act of granting it to us undermines our authenticity. So it's that paradox. We want to be the I who thinks and the I who speaks and the I who is, but we need the other to say that they hear us and that they see us and that they want us, or even that they hate us. We can work with that. It's not as fun, but we've all seen the toddler who wants attention in the grocery store line, and the mom won't give them the attention. You'd think that he'd wait until she could, but it's what we call negative attention, which is better than no attention at all. The child needs to be seen. It's feeling disorganized and chaotic, so it pulls down the candy rack, next to the clerk, and all of a sudden this kid's got all kinds of attention from the clerk, from the mother. Not fun attention as a rule, like, what is the matter with you? Wait till you get home and you can't, blah blah blah. It all comes pouring down on the kid and he's crying his head off, but at least he's been authenticated. And not really, but it but it feels like it. And so we don't fully outgrow that. Sometimes we are willing to be in a very uncomfortable relationship just because it's a relationship. And sometimes, certainly when it gets as bad as domestic abuse, the problem is that the self-esteem of the individual being abused is so low, they can't imagine being authenticated anywhere outside of the abuse. So as horrible as the abuse is, that's their authenticator. So if you're going to successfully intervene in domestic abuse, you're going to have to give the abused, the community that can temporarily make them feel held and seen, so they can recover their self-confidence. Because the epitome of abuse, and Trump is quite an abuser, You can see it in his interviews, you can see it in his rallies. What abusers do is they say, I'm the best you can hope for. I'm the best you deserve. Everything else is worse than me. So you'd better figure out how to get me what I want, because if I abandon you, you will fall into the void, because nobody else cares and you're not worth it. So these are all the things that are added. I think you have probably had plenty of time to try and scribble this, a lot of this down. And so what I have to add here, you can do a look at what maybe you've already done or we'll start. So this is also called the master. And in a sense, you as student, you are the slave of your GPA, not of your professor, because you can walk out of my class anytime. You can turn off this tape anytime. I don't have that. I can't make you work for me. You have a midterm coming up. Am I making you take the midterm? No, but you don't have to take the midterm. You can drop the course now. You cannot take the midterm. So you're not my slave, but the GPA, you don't need to be my slave because you're the slave of the GPA. Therefore I can really count on the fact that you'll show up for the midterm, not for me personally, Professor Leonard, but for the GPA, which is way more powerful and scary than me, because it's an indelible, it's the apparatus allows it to be an indelible mark of your worth, not your self-worth, but it's easy to conflate the two. It's easy to feel like a 3.2, but you know, it works, it cuts you both ways. Let's say you're a 4.0 GPA, then you might want to say, hey, my self-worth is 4.0, but it's really very narrow, you know. These GPAs and these Godots and these Trumps, they pose as the whole horizon, but they're at best one lighthouse with a single beam of light. It's very, very narrow. And you have to look at QAnon. You have to restrict your life to stay in their one tiny beam of light. You got to spend all day on the internet repeating insane conspiracy theories to feel like you're still being seen and authenticated. And in a way, when Trump, the light just blinked out. It's almost like what happens when you turn, you look out at the porch and the light is on and there's 50 moths and they're beating against the glass and they're beating against the glass and the light inside the glass is their GPA. And then you turn the porch light off. What are they going to do? They're lost all of a sudden. They thought they knew where they were and now they don't know who they are or where they are. So be careful that you're not a moth with a single porch light. I mean, there's nothing, GPA can be one of your porch lights, but have some others, or even your chosen career. Maybe you really want to go to med school and maybe that'll happen, but don't have that be your only porch light where you're just in the dark void if you can't get that acceptance and have persuaded yourself that there isn't anything else but that acceptance and therefore you must not exist. Because you didn't achieve the thing that authenticates your existence. So what happens is the way this works, when you're hailed by a master discourse, it demands something from you. And that drops down into the thing that you make for the master to send back to the master so the master will continue to authenticate you. You have to pay for that authentication by working for the master. So the master looks at you and demands that you take the midterm, demands that you write an essay, demands that you work on the assembly line, demands that you work in the mines for cobalt in the Congo. And that labor goes down this line here, and it becomes the commodity or the midterm, and it gets sent back. This is like reverse, but anyway, it gets sent back to the master. So this is how capitalism works, because the demand of the master will exceed what they have a right to ask for. There's no limit to what can be demanded in capitalism. The market supposedly sets the price. So you get offered a job for $8 an hour. If you don't want it, there's five people behind you that do. It doesn't matter that that's an unfair wage. You will take it. You'll send back what you make. And those of you who saw Modern Times know what I'm talking about. You'll send it back to the master. So the master will get you to make something, and he'll pay you $8 to make something that he can sell for $100. this is where this lower right hand corner can become a sweatshop. That you you know, that Nikes can be made, you know, over in Asia, and you can make an Air Jordan, let's say, I'm making these up, but I don't think they're so far off, for say $8 of labor plus the machine, you can make an Air Jordan, but they're, I don't know what they are, $150, $200. So that gives the master capital, not money, yes, money, but money, excess money, more money than they had to lay out to create the shoe. So this is the magic of capitalism, because then they have capital to pour back in to make a bigger factory. They don't have to share it. And then they share it with stockholders. But stockholders are not the people who work. So Nike stockholders, but they're not the people who make Nike shoes. They are people who have money in their own right, and they demand returns for investing in Nike. So the worker, the student, the slave, the labor keeps getting extracted out of them. And this then corresponds to reality. And here's the curtain. The curtain is this diagonal line going across. Would this be easier with a pen? Maybe. I can. I'm just like trying to look at, read something in a mirror for me. So sorry about that. But I may scan this and stick it on just a single announcement note so you can literally have this postcard. So the real is unacknowledged by reality. But what's also being, with the slavery, what's underneath the master is a denied, is the refusal to acknowledge that that the master's split. The reason the master's demanding things is they want to suture over the split of the master who speaks and then the master who is spoken. Masters who speak deny that they're spoken. Trump does not acknowledge ever that anybody has ever done anything for him or that anybody is necessary for who he is. He presents himself as ex nihilo, as something that had no beginning and will, at least according to him, will have no end, the alpha and the omega. That's basic. That's master discourse 101. This is why he literally cannot admit he lost the election. It's not even because he's a jerk. And it's not that he's deluded. He's a master. Masters cannot admit that they are a split subject as well. Their job is to pose as a subject that's not split, so they can make demands of a slave who is split. And the slave will try and send back something so that the master gaze will resolve their suture. But that's never going to happen because the masters are already split too. It just won't acknowledge it. And if taken far enough, this is fascism. This is, you know, the difference between Hitler and Trump is the difference between the Weimar Republic and the USA. Fortunately, the USA has more apparatus than the Weimar Republic. So Hitler just cut through that like a hot knife through butter, but that the US still had plenty of apparatus that Trump couldn't simply break. He tried, he broke windows in the Capitol, but he didn't break windows in democracy, as far as I can tell so far, fingers crossed. Okay, so that is always the issue. And in a successful revolution, the slave would have to be able to go down to the mode of production that makes the shoes, and instead of sending the shoes back, bring whatever value that was over to here, and then have a revolution that showed the cracks in the master. Now, this we're going to see February 8th when we start the impeachment trial. What's going to happen? Trump's not even, you know, it's almost a Beckett issue. Like, what does it mean to impeach a president, to remove them from office when they're not in office? And some people will say, well, it's absurd. And to some degree it is. But then the issue comes up of the fact that does that mean you can do whatever you want? And as long as you step out of office, it doesn't matter. I mean, what's the precedent? What does that say? If Trump hasn't committed impeachable offenses, what is an impeachable offense? So in some ways, you could make the argument that, well, he needs to be convicted for what he did. It doesn't really matter that he's not currently inside the apparatus. We have to convict for what he did when he still was inside the apparatus, because clearly, when he stepped to that microphone and said, you're going to have to be strong if you want to take your country back, he said that from inside the apparatus. I mean, I could have gone up to that microphone and said the exact same thing, and it would have not meant anything. I mean, that's what Beckett's drawing our attention to. I could use Trump's words, and I'm just some professor from the University of Toronto, and people would be like, what is he doing? What is that guy doing up there? They're not going to march on the Capitol because I said it. But because of Trump's position inside the apparatus, the Wizard of Oz, it's messianic. We came because Trump asked us to. We marched on the Capitol because our president told us to. Most of the people, all the people, I would say, who breached the Capitol were making the same mistake as Trump. They thought that if the man who occupies the position of president says, bring down democracy, then you have to obey your president. But that's absurd, because the point of the office of president is to preserve democracy. This is what Trump doesn't seem to get. He's offended that he's being asked to leave the apparatus, so he's going to tear down the apparatus and build a new one that says he can stay. That's totalitarianism. It's not democracy. And there are plenty of governments. Putin is close to that, although he's got some trouble. I'll go into that in another time, because I want to move on a little bit here. So here is, just when you thought it was safe to look at your screen, here is a diagram of your subjectivity. So you'll see there, it's four Venn diagrams. And the four outside Venn diagrams are the symbolic, the imaginary, the real, and the symptom. So language is an attempt to forge a bond between the symbolic and the imaginary. You say the word tree, which is a symbol of a tree, and then people are able to imagine a tree, but there is no tree. I mean, there are trees, but if I'm standing in the classroom, this point is easy to make when I'm actually in front of you and not on a damn camera, but I can be standing in front of you and I say tree, and you all know what I mean. You all imagine a tree, but you don't even imagine the same tree. Some of you might be imagining your Christmas tree, or a tree that got blown down last week, or a maple tree that you like to read under, or where you first built your first tree fort. None of you are going to imagine the same tree, but all of you are going to imagine a tree, and no one's going to be like, what did he just say? Unless you don't know English. And the point is, the relationship between the word tree and an actual tree is one that is forged by consensus, not essence. There's nothing essential in the word tree. There's no treeness in the word tree. It means something because we all have come to understand what that phonetic sound means and how you spell it with our alphabet. In a way, the self is a lot like that you have a self, but the self refers to things that are real, that none of which the self consists of. In the same way that the word tree, relative to whether it's a if it's necessary for the word tree to be a tree, then there is no word tree, because the word isn't a tree. We have to accept that it's a symbol of a tree. And in a way, the self is a symbol of your preferred organization of consciousness. But as such, it's very vulnerable. You can break the relationship between a word and a thing. Give another example. If I say the word dog, you all, again, would make some association, but you would not imagine the same dog. And then if I said white dog, you'd have to recalibrate whatever you're imagining. And then if I said large white dog, you'd have to recalibrate it again. And if I said large angry white dog, it would calibrate further. So in other words, you think that by my saying dog, you're done, but then we have adjectives and adverbs, and every word changes the meaning of everything that has preceded it, which then begs the question, well, did it mean anything? Like when I said the word dog, and then I say white dog, did the image you have of a dog, was that real? Was that, I mean, it was imaginary, but it was an imaginary that you saw as equivalent to what you know of a dog in real life. But then I said white dog, which means that whatever image you had has to be amended. Does that mean that the image you had before was an illusion or fake or a lie? No, it just means that meaning is a weaving and an unweaving. It has no fixed point. That's why Godot, waiting for Godot doesn't mean anything, because it's about meaning, how we construct it, how is the matrix built, and don't forget the apparatus of the matrix and think the irreality is essential, because then you become a slave, as Morpheus says, and you're working in what you think is your own best interest, but you've been given your own best interests. That's one of the things that ideology can do. I mean, who does anybody seriously imagine, who's not already in QAnon, that Trump will ever do anything that will help anybody who's in that movement? I mean, it's safe to say that he will never be of benefit to them. He's not going to raise the minimum wage. He's not going to do any of the things that they need and that they're so desperate and disenfranchised over. He is he's an antichrist that they've raised to cult status. And that's a terrible position to be in as a people, because you're worshiping the source of your own misery and worshiping it as the only possibility of relief from the misery that, in fact, the thing you're worshiping is imposing on you. There's no way out of that circle except to break the self-construction. And that's, in a way, that's the good news. And I mentioned this is the age of depression. Having a nervous breakdown is not always bad. It always feels bad. But sometimes the self-construction that's breaking down was not serving you well. So a bad relationship, flunking a course you need for your major, realizing you're going to grad school, you're going to a grad school your parents want you to go to, not necessarily one you do. These things, whether a nervous breakdown is good or bad, it has nothing to do with the breakdown. It has to do with how you respond to it. And we have that cliche that it's not how you fall down, it's whether or not you get up. And how do you get up? Because sometimes in a panic, you can build the self back to what it was before and stumble on, and you're still vulnerable to another breakdown. Or you can have a deep depression where you don't even want to get out of bed because you have no self-construction. The one you had fell apart. You can't conceive of building another one, and you'll need help. You'll need community. You will need somebody to help you navigate how you feel in relationship to the gaze that you use to attempt to authenticate yourself. So it's not all bad that we don't have an essence, because the essence we have is always constructed. And there's good essences that serve us, and there's terrible essences that leave us debilitated, because it masquerades as an essence. That means we can go in there and change it. We can, as Dorothy does in The Wizard of Oz, just take, break the machinery. Like she has to pay the price when, Dorothy wants to get back to Kansas. She doesn't want to find the little guy behind the curtain. She doesn't want to find out that he's a fraud, and that this thing that seemed powerful enough to bring her back to Kansas can do nothing at all. That's a terrible discovery. Notice, of course, that the wizard promptly gives symbols to the cowardly lion, gets a medal, and the tin man gets a heart, and scarecrow gets a PhD, so that he can feel smart in relation to a symbol of smartness. So Vladimir is a symbolic, and Estragon's the imaginary. So Estragon just keeps trying to imagine that he could take his boot off, but there's nothing to be done. The symbolic always wants to do, and the imaginary is always fantasizing about being. So one fantasizes about doing, the other fantasizes about being. And as I point out, waiting is an awareness of being brought on by an absence of doing. So waiting makes you aware of the split in yourself, that there's an I who speaks and there's an I that's spoken. Because once you stop doing, because when you shift from speaking to being spoken, you don't acknowledge the shift, you don't feel the shift. But if you're forced to wait, you're suspended in the lack between the I that speaks and the I that is spoken. Pozo is the symptom. So if all four of these are a single subjectivity, then there's the part of you that tries to symbolize your existence. It's the part of you that can only imagine your existence. And then there's a part of you that has symptoms because of the irreconcilability of those first two things. So your symptom could be a headache, or your symptom could be, I want to go to the mall, or your symptom can be the car you drive. It's an excess to the symbol, to the symbolic, that the symbolic can't incorporate. So when you go to a psychiatrist and I can't sleep and I have a headache, that's because that symptom is all the things your symbolic refuses and that your imaginary can't incorporate. So again, nightmares and dreams are they're in the realm of the symptom. They're not symbolic. They're not imaginary. They're the inevitable excess of the irreconcilable tension between the symbolic and the imaginary. And then lucky is the closest thing to the real, the thing beyond reality. And what's shocking about Lucky's speech is reality's crumbling as we listen. You can see the real seeping into his monologue. That's part of its genius. You'll notice toward the end of the monologue, he starts talking about stones and skulls. And he didn't begin that way, but his language is failing. And as language fails, the symbolic blinks out. There's no relationship to the imaginary. The symptom, in a way, becomes foremount. I mean, in the lucky symptomatic, to say the least, carrying sand around in briefcases, that doesn't mean anything. But more than he's symptomatic on the way to a breakdown, because the symptom is a safety valve. Like when your symbolic and your imaginary are out of sync, believe it or not, your headache is your friend. And even your sense of depression or anxiety is trying to help. It's trying to say there's a disconnect and a dislocation between your symptomatic and your imaginary, between your symbolic and your imaginary. The curtain of your reality is starting to rip. You don't want to feel the full force of the disorganized chaos of the real. So pay attention to your symptom to figure out why your reality is ripping. Because if you ignore your symptom, it will get worse until the reality rips. It's one thing to be feeling a little bit depressed and you go to work, but if you ignore everything, 2 months later, you can't get to work. You can't finish a day's work. Then the symptom starts to have effects in reality. Like you could lose a job or lose a relationship. So then you'll notice if we move in side here, there's four more circles. So in between the symbolic and the imaginary is demand. So the symbolic demands, I should say it this way. The imaginary demands that the symbolic be the equivalent of its imagination, but it can't be. I mean, you can want a nice red Porsche, and you can demand that you that a nice red Porsche be brought to you, and that would be the symbolic. It would be an actual car, but that's not going to happen. Now you could imagine owning a red Porsche, and then you go to work, and you have a career, and you make a lot of money, and you find and you can pay $60,000 for a car, and now you've got a red Porsche. But the imaginary didn't earn the money for that. The symbolic did. So when children are first born, they operate on the imaginary level primarily. They imagine food because they're hungry. They don't know what food is. They don't know what breastfeeding is. All they know is they're crying because there's a lack in them, a physiological lack that hurts. And then in most cases, one hopes their crying achieves, they get fed. So the baby thinks they figured it out. The world's imaginary. Like anything I want, all I have to do is imagine it and it will happen. The mother's busy. Let's say it takes 2-3 minutes for her to get all the way upstairs after your nap when you're crying at, say, 2 months old. This is really upsetting because your imaginary is failing to bring food to your mouth. And eventually you'll begin to realize that you have to make your imaginations known. I mean, by the time you're dating, or let's say, you can't, you know, say to yourself, want my date to kiss me now, and then be like, why didn't that work? You could say, do you mind if I kiss you? And then it might or might not work, because then you'd be making your imagination would finally is making a demand of the symbolic. And the answer could be, no, I don't mind. Or it could be, no, I don't think of you that way. Or, you know, all these different things. So the imaginary runs up against either the stone wall of the symbolic or the opening portal of the symbolic. So that's what demand is. And I'll get to give you another example. let's go to need, which is kind of in between the symbolic and the symptom. Need is something like you're thirsty, and so you drink water. Demand, So need is primal. It can be satisfied. Need can be satisfied. But demand is essentially smuggles into need something else that wants, that isn't strictly water. So if you're wondering how much your partner cares about you, you could say, I'm thirsty. And if your partner says, oh, let me bring you a glass of water, that's partly met the demand that's hidden inside the request, which is not just I'm thirsty, but do you care enough about me to care about my thirst? And do you then care even more than that to put some labor into quenching my thirst? Because obviously if you say I'm thirsty and they're like, well, you know, taps over there, or you got a broken leg, or, you know, that be like, wow, okay, that didn't go well. So really when you say I'm thirsty, you're also saying, do you love me? But of course the person is only hearing I'm thirsty. And couples get into this all the time. Like, why don't you ever say I love you? Why do I have to say it? I said it. Well, you have to keep saying, because the in order to negotiate the balance between the symbolic and the symptom in this case being anxiety, what if he or she doesn't love me? I need a glass of water. Sure, I'll get you one, sweetie. Okay, that's not about water. That's about recalibrating the balance between the symbolic and the symptom. So in between the symptom and the real is lack, and it never goes away. Lack is at the base of desire. You can't desire something you have. So desire is evidence of really a perpetual lack. We lack the ability to join up the I that speaks with the I that's spoken, and anything we shovel into the gap between those two things just goes right through it, like the bucket with a hole in it. So we have to figure out a way to slow that down, to deal with our lack. And there are many, many ways to do that. But Pozo is symptomatic, in the sense that he's like, where's my chair? Where, you know, I've got these chicken bones. I'm pulling this guy to market. I'm still in charge. What time is it? Do you know who I am? He's all over the place. And then lucky, as I said, it's the last bulwark between crashing in of a chaotic real into a constructed reality. And the other, then we go into four more, even tinier little places. And I couldn't even fit the words in. So I put 1, 2, 3, 4 over here. And in between need, demand, and desire is all these things that substitute for lack. So one of the most obvious would be the commodity. Number one, which can insinuate itself into the maelstrom of the symbolic, the demand, the need. So a deodorant or something will advertise itself as what will hold those rings together, because these rings, this is like a Borromean knot. If any one of these rings breaks, the others start to also unravel, because this is a single piece of string. You know, it may look like discrete circles because I don't know how else to draw it, but it's a single string that's looped around all these things. So if you cut the string anywhere, you cut the string everywhere. And this is why the ego is kind of a paranoid construction. Because after the commodity, you have the fetish, and the commodity is a fetish. A fetish is any object that we place as the inside the equivalent of our lack. We assume it's the same shape as our lack. It never is, but it can sometimes be made to seem that way. The other way we deal with this is through labor, through working. As I said, get your Porsche. You want a Porsche, get a job. And the fourth, and this is what's postmodern, this is new, is this is not always been the case, is you can now have savings in capital, and you can use that to fill your lack. What we call retail therapy, or, you know, if you're Jeff Bezos and you have $100 billion, that's good, but $110 billion is better. Not clear why. He can't possibly spend all that he has now. But capital accrues, and you can mistake the accruing of capital for the authentication of existence and of your uniqueness, which is why capitalism is a very selfish system, because the ego is never satisfied and lack is never filled. So once you design an economic system where money can make money, you're taking money off out of the grid. You're taking people's labor and you're shipping it to offshore islands. You're not sharing it anymore. And now there's only investment and there's no longer sacrifice. And that's that may lead to a material, to a growth in material acquisitions, but it's a spiritual dearth. Nothing, you know, I mean, as I said, I think in the other class, money talks, but all it ever says is goodbye. It's not, it doesn't, it passes through you, just like the objects of desire. So that's why Godot is so important and such a foundational work of postmodernism. And because Beckett doesn't answer the question, he asks a better question. And that's what we need. We don't need more answers in postmodernism. Go to Google, get billions of answers. None of them help in the sense in the existence. Information is not wisdom. Wisdom is what you do with information. And that is hard in postmodernism, because wisdom usually attempts to have a leverage point that's outside of the cause and effect of the everyday world, such as God or even a president or someone that's allowed to be. I mean, there's a reason that the president, you know, can't be indicted. Again, it's not that Trump can't be indicted. It's that we don't want someone inside the apparatus of the presidency to be subject to indictment, because it damages the apparatus. The presidency can't function. And again, Trump seems to misunderstand that somehow he's above the law. The apparatus is allowed to be above the law, but not the person in it. Although in the case of the president, there's almost a unique situation where you're allowed to be above the law while you're inside the apparatus. And this is what will be happening on February 8th. Are you then subject to the law again after you step out of the apparatus? Because if you're not, then there's no limit to what you can do when you're inside the apparatus, because all you have to do, you can do it all. This is the issue with war crimes too. Like what does that even mean? I mean, war is already a crime. What's a war crime? Somehow inside the parameters of the atrocities of war, there's something that's even worse. Well, that's what they decided at the end of World War II when they had the Nuremberg trials, and Hitler had shot himself, but his cronies were still running around, and they had unleashed the Third Reich on the world. They had, you know, killed 6 million innocent people at least. And there was a sense that they had to be tried, and many of them were hung. They were executed as war criminals. And the idea, whether we agree with it or not, is that sometimes there's a behavior within humanity that we refuse to acknowledge as humane in any way. And the Geneva Convention attempted to do this. This is how prisoners should be treated, even though we're all trying to kill each other. So we are always looking for that vantage point outside of the fray. But in postmodernism, it's a crisis, because there's no God figure, there's no Godot. And that's what's dawning. If it's not dawning on Vladimir and Estragon, this play is taking a step away from the modern and into the postmodern, because it is foregrounding the idea that doubling down on the idea that you're going to keep coming back every day, because Godot didn't say he wasn't coming. He said he couldn't make it today, but he would make it tomorrow. But he said that yesterday. And the modern dilemma is you just stay. And Vladimir and Estragon are really still modern. The play is postmodern. And the audience is forced into postmodernism by this play, watching these two modernist characters completely lost, that all they can do is repeat a strategy that worked in modernism but doesn't work in postmodernism, and that is to just preserve the illusion of your self-construction by continuing to put it, inhabit the not yet. Vladimir is not yet. Estragon is now. Pozo is then. And Lucky is nowhere. And space and time. But there's the tree. And I had an interesting conversation in the open classroom because a student was asking about, well, what about the tree? There were three leaves on the tree. And that's very important because that's the only form of development in this play that sustains. Everything else is reversible. Everything else is circular. But the tree grew three new leaves. Now, why and how does a tree grow leaves? It doesn't fantasize leaves. It doesn't imagine leaves. It doesn't ask other trees to look at it and say, you have leaves. The leaf comes out of a perfect balance of kind of need, demand, and desire. That without a leaf, the tree can't take advantage of the sun. The photosynthesis that brings energy to the tree is done on the interface of a leaf and the sun, not the tree and the sun, but the leaf and the sun. And even that, and in turn, but the leaf is not independent from the tree either, because a leaf can't just appear in the sky. A leaf has to be on a tree. So trees die without leaves. Leaves die without trees. That should be the relationship we strive to have with one another, mutual reciprocity for a good that encompasses us both. We live in a binary world where people are like, are you a leaf or are you a tree? Are you black or are you white? Are you rich or are you poor? Do you love me or not? Everything's a binary. Computers run on binaries. Algorithms run on binaries. 1 0 1 0 1 0. The matrix. But binaries are not, that's just the weaving of the curtain of reality. Binaries have nothing to do with the real. They're simply a way to pretend that the chaos is something else. Even gender binaries, a boy, girl, man, woman. And then we get homophobic or misogynistic because we are terrified that our binary systems will fail. So either if you're a man, be a man. If you're a woman, be a woman, and that's it. Don't be a man and desire like a woman, or what we say is the way a woman desires. So it's, bisexuality, transsexuality, the entire LGBTQ is a threat to binarism. And that's where actual violence and hatred can emerge from something that does seem odd. Like, why would I hate or do violence to someone because they desire in a different way? How is that my business? How is that a threat to me? Well, an individual who desires differently than me is not a threat to me. But the fact that that's possible is a threat to the binarisms in relation to which I determine what's possible and impossible. Because master discourse is good at declaring what's possible and what's impossible, drawing the line between what's possible and impossible. Masters, tyrants, they're very good at pretending that they are the entire horizon. There is nothing to the left of them, to the right of them, above them or under them. They are the sun. They are the heliocentric force of life, and there is no other possible source. And abusers do that too, and domestic abusers do that. I'm the only one who can fix it. I'm the only one who knows the problem. I'm the only one that can provide for you. It doesn't matter what I demand of you. There's no demand of mine that's excessive because I'm everything. And that's not true. And so one of many ways to begin to get out of being abused is, even if you can't see it, know that there's always a much wider horizon than someone who's controlling you claims. The other problem with the self needing the other and the other needing the self in postmodernism is that in modernism there was still a kind of what I would call the hell do I call it? It's getting late. I'm a little tired. It's one problem with these lectures. Compulsive complementarity is a phrase I use sometimes for this assumption that if you find your perfect partner, they will complete you and you will complete them. Now, there can be mutual reciprocity in relationships, and that can be really sustaining, but there is no perfect complementarity, and the compulsion to find a perfect complementarity actually tends to destroy the reciprocity. And I'm going to take a chance here and do something I haven't done before and share my screen. I was kind of playing with this before, and I wonder if it will let me do it. Share application screen. If I do that, but what I really want to share is this. And okay, so that's that. But then how do I start? Whoa, the video. I wonder. Let's see. Okay, maybe this is working. So hopefully you're seeing a couple made out of clay. It's a man and a woman, a binary. He smiles. She blinks her eyes. He touches her hand. She accepts that. Now he's happy. He does a little kiss. And they actually do a kiss and they land. And this is that. The excitement of sexual desire is probably a sense of merge, ecstasy, even have a drug name. It's not that these two people have become a single play, it's that they feel it. And they're able to move in and out of their sense of themselves apart from one another, and their sense of themselves as transcendent together. Now here's the part where there's a problem. When they've come back apart and they've had that perfection, that compulsive complementarity, which they have both insisted that they are the perfect completion of one another. But when they come back out, whatever part of themselves they don't know incorporate into themselves is in the space between the two of them. Whose is it? The tendency is to feel that it's the other person's, like they've left a part of themselves on the table and then they need to take it back and put it in them because it's not yours. But they think the opposite, that it, that must be you. So neither person can recognize what they own in this combined blob, which is really the amalgam of everything they each reject in one another, which the ecstasy of the union seemed to finally make a reality. So watch what happens. I could also make the argument that this blob is the symptom. Like, so they've removed this symptom from their subjectivity. So they feel like they have a perfect balance of the symbolic, the imaginary, and the real, and that therefore the veil of reality and the real are coterminous and indistinguishable, which is why the stakes are very high, that they not permit this back into their balance, because then it will be out of balance again, which it always is and still is. So this is both the rejection of the symptom and the attempt to make the symptom unsymptomatic. But it's you can't get rid of it, and you don't want to get rid of it. you need it. It's partly what makes up the human drive that we can't incorporate. And for those of you in my Hollywood romance, I could easily, and who knows, I may even show this in Hollywood romance, because we can see this problem of intimacy and vulnerability and versus negotiation, because they went from negotiation to vulnerability to intimacy, and then they came out of the intimacy, and now they're negotiating again to who's going to bear the burden of the symptom. And you see this in relationships where it was an imbalance in the relationship. One partner can be seem happier because the other partner is feeling a need and a demand and desire that are not being met, and yet they don't want to leave, and the other person doesn't want them to go, because this is what I call the vampiric relationship of self and other in A10. But so you get these dependency relationships, or what we call codependency, which mimic mutual reciprocity, but in fact there's a fundamental power differential that gets built to the relationship that offers secondary gains to both of the partners. So the partner who benefits from the power differential puts up with not caring as much about the other person, and the person who's not cared about as much is willing to shoulder the symptom in order to continue to be in the relationship. So notice that was the first kind of violence, for want of a better word. Now there's anger between the two people saying, take it, this is yours, I know it's yours, and this will be returned the same way. And then the laugh, I think, the sense of humiliation brings on the next act of violence, which is to push into the basic form of the other person's self-construction. Okay. Did that work? Maybe. You can tell me if that worked. Somebody send me an email when they see this and say, oh yeah, I saw that video and then you came back. I don't know. It's like the beginning of Godot. So there you are. Am I? I may be here, but am I here in relation to you? And what's the difference? So I'm going to try, since we're being crazy, I'm going to try one other thing. Maybe, okay. Share files. I thought because I loaded this file on here, but I wonder if I can do that. I'm supposed to do something. All right, well, that's annoying. I did pull it up where I screen shared a document. It just doesn't seem to be happening right now. Why did I want to share that document? It was basically the notes from the class. But that's all right. It's getting late. The balcony, let me just give you a segue to the balcony, as I think I already have, but it will open. Well, let me just cut to a sort of scene that gets repeated, to give you the sense of the dynamic that you're looking for. Here's the slogan I want you to write on a piece of paper while you're reading the balcony. Power is an effect of relationship. Now, I've already made that point with the master discourse. The master is only the master because there's a slave. And there's no mastery in the master. There's no slavishness in the slave. The master is the master and the slave is the slave because of the relationship one has to the other. And those relationships can shift around. A master can become a slave. A slave can become a master. A president can try and hang on to a presidency and break the apparatus to do it. or they're out and somebody else is now inside that apparatus. And it's in the same way that apparatus once made them president, they are now making someone else president. And through that same construction, making them a former president. Because there's really, there's no other demarcation. I mean, Trump didn't change outfits or shift his DNA, nor did Biden. There was a transfer of power. That was supposed to be peaceful. It wasn't. And when it isn't, it puts the whole system, in this case, democracy, at risk. So you're going to watch power plays throughout the balcony. So a man who is a plumber by day, comes to the brothel and hires a prostitute, but he really wants this role. They're much more they're interested in the role playing. There's no actual sex in the play. I mean, there's sexual tension, and it does make you, Genet, the author, makes the kind of the brilliant and unsettling point that we always reach our sexual partners partly through imagination. And I mean, you can have specific role play if you want, and Lord knows there's websites for every preferred role play, the naughty nurse and the secretary and the boss. But notice that when you look at pornography is, the way I define pornography is less about who's doing what to whom and more about, is the power differential worked out in advance so you can enjoy the sexual play without any worrying about anybody who's being raped or abused. Somehow both, whatever they're doing, that it seems they're in the pornographic modality, it seems the woman always wants to do whatever the man wants to do, and somehow vice versa. That's what pornography does, is it suspends the power differential. So obviously if a boss is having sex with the secretary, even if the secretary has said that's okay, how do we define consent? The boss can fire her or him. So if someone who can fire you wants to have a sexual relationship with you, you're not on equal footing. So whether you say yes or no, and of course in many professions it's illegal and certainly unethical. Teachers and students, psychiatrists and patients, religious leaders and members of their parish or congregation, it's understood that it's a violation of trust to use the power differential to secure a sexual access, even if the other person insists that it was their idea too. This is why we have the concept of statutory rape, that if you're under 14, I think that you don't even discuss consent. If an adult has had sex with someone 14 or under, it's rape, no matter what the 14-year-old says. And that's partly to protect confused 14-year-olds from defending their abusers in a kind of Stockholm syndrome. So this plumber pretends in one of the scenarios, we see him pretending to be a judge and the prostitute plays a thief. And he keeps questioning her, what did you steal? How much did you steal? Did you really steal it? Or are you just saying you stole it? And then he says, don't you read the key line here, which I'm gonna leave you with, because it operates throughout the balcony. He says, I can't be a perfect judge if you're not a perfect thief. And that's the master slave, right? And she gets mischievous and realizes that, if she doesn't, if she starts to back away from her agreed upon role play as a thief, it will erode his imaginary position as a judge. So she starts saying, maybe I didn't steal all those things. Maybe I didn't steal any of those things. And he's like, please, don't. But it's part of their role play. That's what's so weird. They're swapping the power differential back and forth. And he's like, don't do that. And then she says, kneel, crawl to me. This is either making you want to go read this play or throw it out. I don't know. But it's a classic. It's one of the great plays, considered to be one of the great plays of the 20th century. It's worth noting that Jean Genet was adopted by because his mother was a prostitute and he never knew his father. So he went to an orphanage and then he was adopted by a farm couple in France. He's French. The original of the balcony is written in French. You have a translation that Genet oversaw, so it's about as good as you're going to get. But we can see why Janae is so good at saying, you know, everything is the result of power differential. Like, what does it mean to be a child? I mean, the farm couples in at this time, farm couples, you know, Anna Green Gables is actually a little like this. It, farmer people who needed workers would adopt children. And I don't know if you've read Anna Green Gables, but they were supposed to get a boy and they wound up getting a girl, and they're unhappy about it because part of the adoption deal was to have a worker for the farm. So it's said to be the same as parents adopting or having a child, but adoption has that implication in it that there's conditions. And so Janet became a thief, in fact, and he was imprisoned. He was a kind of a career thief, and finally was serving a very long sentence for being a thief. But he started writing, and his writing came to the attention of Jean-Paul Sartre, the great kind of founder of existentialism. And Sartre pulled some strings. He'd never done armed robbery. He'd never killed or even wounded anyone. So he got Janet out of jail, and Janet continued to write. And The Balcony is a masterpiece of the illusions of power, the way that people try and get you to forget that we have power is an effective relationship. Power doesn't exist. It's a differential. It's of who's occupying the position of master, who's occupying the position of slave. As soon as the curtain gets pulled back, that little old man is the least powerful person in the room. And the second before that curtain was pulled, he was the most powerful. And that's what revolution can do too. So Saddam Hussein was arrested and executed. Gaddafi was torn apart in the streets. Mussolini, same fate. These people who had ultimate power, I can't tell you where to go with someone like Putin, but if enough things go wrong, he'll be torn apart. The resistance is mounting. I don't know if this current insurrection going on in Russia or the protests against the man who was first poisoned and now has been jailed. But I think Putin's nervous. He's arrested 3,000 people. He hasn't had to. He's a nervous wizard. Somebody's tugging at his curtain. But anyway, this is because I'm annoyed at him anyway, because he started smack talking the American democracy. And granted, we deserve, we as someone from America, some humiliation in that regard. But still, it's annoying that he jumped on it. So I'm glad he's got issues in his own house now. All right, I'll wrap this up. I hope I've said enough. I'll scan those funny little charts I did for you. Now, don't worry, the midterm's not going to be like what's the relationship between need and demand. It's not going to be anything like that. These charts are for you to help you think of all the different ways you can think. I'm not interested in your memorizing the need, demand, desire. It's a kaleidoscope. It's a wheel of fortune to help you. But I'm more interested in you talking about, I'm not going to give you a question. I'm going to give you quotes from Godot. These charts are just aids. So don't be terrified, especially you scientists out there. Because I know whenever you get shown a chart, like the periodic table or whatever, it's like you got to nail it. And this is not the periodic table, although it's the closest thing to a periodic table of your subjectivity. And you can think of all those things as elements. And the genius of the periodic table is that virtually every element and every possible combination of every possible element is in that table. So it's amazing. And arguably my little ring the particles, the elements of your subjectivity in endless combination. But that's the key point. The periodic table is not a nuclear reaction, even though it contains everything that could allow you to do everything from nuclear fission to, you know, to dissolving salt in water. It's all there. But the periodic table itself is static. Memorizing it doesn't make you, doesn't allow you to invent the atomic bomb or you know, anything else. Same with mine. It's not memorizing the elements. It's learning the dynamic and finding a way to interact with the dynamic that allows you to to formulate insights and perceptions that would have not been possible without this arrangement, but the arrangement itself is not the perception that the arrangement permits. All right, I'll leave you to ponder that. And if anybody out there, just give me a shout out. Or I'll see you Wednesday morning at 11. You can tell me then whether this might, and why I couldn't get that text up there is annoying, but that's okay. All right, so good night. I'm gonna go have some tea. Okay.